Welcome back to the shop, everybody. And we are over here on the Monarch lathe, which seems to be everyone's favorite lathe in the shop. We're going to get started on our next piece for the truck hitch crane, and that's going to be the pin. We're going to be using this piece of 3.5 inch 1045 material here. This is an old hydraulic rod that I salvaged. This is great stuff for making all kinds of different parts in the shop. And so I've got a few pieces of this that I had saved from a previous job and pull it out whenever we need to make something. So we're going to use the forejaw, and we're just going to be machining a simple pin that is going to get welded to one of the flanges that I previously showed. And then this pin right here will actually slip down in the bushing that we're going to machine that will hold the actual crane assembly. Okay, so it's going to be, we're going to do a little bit of heavy turning over here today. I'll show you guys the turning tool that we're going to use. But let's go ahead and get this guy. I've already got my forejaw preset to 3.5 inches. And we're going to chuck this guy up, get it running nice and true. And once we get it running concentric, we'll come in here, make a very light face cut on this, drill a center hole to support it, and then we're going to make our heavy turning. There's not a lot of turning to be done on this, but we're going to make a few passes with some heavy turning action right there. So let me go find my indicator and we'll get this guy trued up. I oftentimes get asked why I don't put two indicators on a part like this when I'm doing some indicating. As most of you guys are aware that watch me know that I usually use one indicator. We'll indicate this side with the forejaw, come down here to this side, bump it around. I keep moving it back and forth. For me, it's just a simpler way to do it than running two indicators. But we're going to go ahead and run two indicators today. I'll go ahead and put one out here on this end. And then that way we're not moving it back and forth. And you guys can kind of see it in real time how this is going to work. So let's see how far. We're not out very far at all because I had that thing set. So we're only 8 thousandths out right there. That's our low. That's our high. So anytime you get within that range right there, always make sure that your jaws are tight first. So tighten your highs and you're going to move it around. Don't worry about that, but you got to make sure that the jaws are tight. So I've already got it there. I mean, just within a couple, but see that one's loose. So that means I'm gonna have to tighten the other side right here. But that's what you want to make sure of before you just say, oh man, that thing's running true. You got to make sure that all these jaws are nice and tight so it doesn't try to move on you whenever you go to make your cut, especially out here on an outer end like this, even with a center. And you go in here and you try to make a heavy pass, it's going to try to lift this and pull it out some. So that's within 1/1000ths right there. It's really not bad at all. So what are we on this end? I haven't even looked yet. All right, so we're still a good, that's about 12/1000ths out on this end here. We'll just use our lead knocker. Come around here and eyeball the high, which is about here. I always try to line it up with a jaw if I can. Sometimes it's in between there, no big deal. So I just kind of start with the high. Just give it a couple bumps. Now we're within 4. And it's not super critical on something like this that you have to be dead nuts accurate and true when you're just going to be turning it down. But you want to start with a nice true work piece to begin with. So that end right there is within a couple. It's going to be close enough. I'm going to go ahead and I want to recheck these. Go ahead and give them just a little bit of pull. You just kind of have a feel for it once you do it long enough to know how tight it needs to be. If you can twist on this T-wrench and feel it kind of give a little bit, you know that needs to be a little tighter. So we're still 1/1000ths off. And we're gonna leave it there because that's nice and tight. So 1/1000ths here. And on this side, we tweaked it again. Let's see if we can improve that just a touch. So that's 1/1000ths and a half, near 2/1000ths right there. There's no need to do it, but let's try it anyway. All right, 1/1000ths and a half right there. We're gonna leave it alone. That is indicated well. Move these guys out of the way and we'll set up our tool. I'm gonna show you my turning tool first that we're gonna use to rough it. We'll finish it with a CNMG insert tool, but we want to give this a nice face, put a center in there, and then we'll start our turning. I want to show you the stick tool that we're going to be using to do the turning on the shaft right here. So this is the one that has always been my favorite insert for roughing and taking heavy metal removal rates on the big lathe right there. So you can see what the part number is. All right. So one of the things I was going to point out is that this is not the one that I used to show in the videos a while back when I was doing the heavy turning. It was actually this guy right here. This is the original, and you can see it's pretty well chowdered up there on the end. And just as I left it the last time that I showed using this, and it ended up breaking right in the middle of a big heavy cut and rubbing it. And it's probably still a good tool to use once you get all the stuff off there, but I just never bothered with it. It is fixable, but I just never messed with it. Ended up finding this guy on eBay, and it was brand new, and I got it for a great price. I think it was like 40 bucks or so that I bought that on eBay. So I just replaced it. But this is the next size up insert right here. So this one that I used to always use is a number 40. And then this one is going to be a number 80 insert right there for this style. This is an LNMX type of insert, and they do have a right hand and a left hand, and they're not reversible either. So you got to either use it on the right-handed tool or the left-handed tool, and that actually then the inserts will indicate on there as well as an R and L in case you look at it, you're not sure which one it is. So you can see the size difference right here on the two inserts. So that's the number 40, that's the number 80. And what that allows you to do is get a little bit more chip out of that. So you can take a deeper cut with the larger size insert than with the smaller one right there. You can still take a quarter inch off of with that one right there. Probably more, I don't remember what the full depth is. But this one right here, you can really go in there a little bit deeper because you have a wider area on the top of the insert right here. This area right in here is what you're gonna have. So actually, let me just do a little measuring here and see if I can get it in there for you. So I'd imagine you can take, so that's approximately 5/16. You might be able to get away with 3/8 right there. But I don't know if you can do that or not. I haven't tried that, but you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna take probably, we're gonna take 400 thousandths off at a time. So you're looking at, about 200 thousandths per side right there. And you can see there's still more insert edge there that you can do. But I have taken off a half inch at a time on the old Monarch, and you can really tell it's pushing it to do it, especially using these carbide inserts. These type of tools, they take a lot of power to be able to pull a chip with these things. It's different when you're using a real sharp high speed tool bit and running low and slow. You can take a deeper cut and you got more torque with the low end gears there. So, but anyway, I wanted to give you a little update on that. So this is the guy we're gonna be using, and we'll make us a few nice heavy passes with this guy right here and have a little fun. And then once we're through with the heavy cutting with this guy, we'll put our other normal everyday finishing insert in there, and we'll get us a nice finish on that shaft. Yeah, that cleaned up fine. Like I said, we do our heavy turning. That'll bring it down because we're gonna be turning this down to 2.5 inches. I forgot to tell you the dimensions there, but yeah. So 2.5 inches, so all that'll be turned off. So we're gonna turn it down to 2.5, and we're gonna turn it back 6 inches right here. This isn't gonna be a critical dimension. We're just gonna scale it, set a zero, and that's gonna be it right there. Go ahead and cut us a center point in there. Let's get our length set. We're just going to use a hook rule, hook the end of it, line up the edge of the cutting tool there on the rule. We're going to go down to 6 inches. Like I said, we're just going to eyeball this on 6. This is not a critical dimension. If it's over, if it's under some, it isn't going to hurt the job one way or the other. So there we are at 6 inches, right on the line. I'm going to slide a indicator up here to the end of the carriage and just set a zero. Set a zero like that, and then that's going to be our stopping point right there. All right, let's get her set up to do our cut, and I'm going to go ahead and get the coolant going. Always turn the pump on and then just get it kind of purged there. Now, one of the problems with trying to capture video with this flood coolant on this heavy turning is that you have a lot of splashing going on right here. Tends to want to splash up on the camera, which ends up hindering the view of the viewer there once we're in editing. So I'm going to get some video here with the GoPro. I'm also going to use my phone because it does excellent video, especially for close-ups. You get a lot more detail with that. So we're just going to do a little mix there of the two cameras. So we've got the machine set at 319 RPM. That's what we're going to start with there. We'll probably bump it up to 420. And then I've got the tumbler gears here set to, it's 20 thousandths. So it's, all right, so it's 19 thousandths per revolution. The next one up is actually 21. So I'm going to be a little conservative and start at 19. All right, and then I was going to point out the surface speed on these inserts. It's recommended 460 to 1,050. So that's pretty fast. We're actually going to be running right around 300 surface speed per minute with your 319 RPM range there. We're ready to start making our first cut. I got to change feed direction. All right, we are ready to go. Let me check it. Nope, I lied to you. I didn't have the feed rate set right. There we go. That looks good. So let's get our coolant pumping. This changes a little bit as it starts pumping and moving. The flow changes just a little bit. Trying to get it right on the tip of that tool there. And one thing I forgot is my earplugs. Let me do that. This does make a lot of screaming noise, so highly suggest always use some earplugs or keep them in your pocket when you're doing this kind of turning, because it makes some noise and it bothers my ears. I don't know about yours, but it bothers me. All right, here we go. Nothing to it. Doing great. Let me move this off for just a second so you can kind of see. Yeah, it's handled that 300 just fine. We only got an inch to take off, so I just figured I'd take three cuts of 300 thousandths, and that'll leave us 100 thousandths to finish it with our other tool bit. All right, well that did good. So like I said, that was removing 300 thousandths and it handled it just fine right there. I know it can handle a lot more, but let's just do three passes at 300 thousandths and get it down pretty quick that way. Second pass. See, one of the problems when you're having fun like this and you're taking these heavy cuts you get it down so fast that before you know it, you're through with the heavy turning. The heavy cuts are always my favorite thing to do. It's fun to watch. It's fun to watch the chip control, the shape of the chip coming down, all that good stuff. So let me go ahead and get a measurement here and see about where we're at. So it's saying 2.885 is where we're at. So I think what I'll do, we'll step it up a little bit and we'll take an extra 50 thousandths on this pass. So I'm gonna dial this in 350 and this will be our final roughing cut. We'll see where we're at. We've already got our CNMG insert in here. We're going to use that to finish it out. And I am going to put an undercut radius in here. I want it undercut because I want this shoulder. This shoulder is going to be what's going to be taking the load of the crane. It's going to be setting the nylon bushing is going to be sitting up against this face right there. So instead of having some kind of thrust bearing, my idea is that we're going to use this face here to pivot and swivel on the top of that bushing there. And we'll, hopefully that's gonna work. If it doesn't work, if it proves to be too much friction, then we'll come back and we'll modify it and we'll put some kind of bearing in here. We're gonna start with that because just trying to keep it simple. I wanna see where we landed on our rough cut right there. So 32, it's 532. Where are we at out here on the end? It's at 532.5. All right, so we'll go ahead and we're just gonna finish this out, make a nice clean face cut right there, and then we'll get a little radius tool and cut an undercut radius right in there. I'm gonna go ahead and touch off this tool right here and just go ahead and reset my zero. And we'll clean that up as we need. And we're spinning up as fast as we can, 700 RPM. Let's just go ahead and make a we'll make a 15 thou cut and see where we landed. That's a 10 thousandths feed rate, by the way. And it is not wanting to pull a chip. Usually it does. We're just going to let it run, though. I'm going to stand back and make sure it doesn't whip me. Try to get it down inside there just like that. All right, we'll mic it out and see where we landed and just make one more cut to finish this journal. That's at 518. And that's at 517.5. Half a thousandth taper there, the opposite direction. I'm not worried about that. That's nice and straight. We're gonna go ahead, I'll just dial in 18 on the dial for that end right there. and we're just going to match the bushing to fit this, whatever it's at. So that's another reason why it's not that critical in what we land on. You're just always playing a game with yourself, trying to shoot for the exact number that you want. Now I'm going to redo that face, although it cleaned it up there. I want to go ahead and get our undercut in there, and then we'll touch that face up. I want to make sure we have a nice smooth face on that without a high feed rate across there. Just make it as smooth as we can. See what I landed on, if I hit my number or if I overshot it or what I did. And I don't know if you can see it or not. We landed right on it. 5.5. I'm sorry. Why did I say 5.5? 2.5 is what I meant. I was looking at the 5, so my mind was thinking 5.5. And then we're 0.5 under on this end right there. Here's our radius tool that I'll use. It's a top-notch style, and this is 3/16 wide. So once we touch off, we'll probably just go like 0.00 deep on that, and that should clear the radius once it slides up on there. This is just another op that I'm going to eyeball everything. Get in there really close to that face, like that. And then once I touch off on the journal, right there, I'm going to set my zero here. I'm going to make sure I go 0.00 and clean that entire radius up. And that's a little bit fast. Let's slow her down a little bit. I'll go ahead and let's put a drop of coolant on here to help that insert. Go into the face a little bit, bring it back into my depth. Just want to make sure that radius is fully cleaned up right there. All right, and then that'll give me a little bit of room to come in there with my facing tool and go ahead and clean this face up again. So a quick way just to verify that your corner is going to clear what it's sliding down in, just take a scale, set it down on there, and slide it all the way up, and just look into that corner. You should be touching the face right here, and the corner of that scale should be clear, and it is. All right, let's clean that face up. Just going to touch it. Let's just take like 0.05. Running 700 RPM. Just want a nice smooth face on that. Come down, should be able to clear into that radius. Just like that. All right, that's looking good there. That cleaned up nicely. Let's take this one out. I'm going to grab my MCHNN and we're going to do a couple of chamfers. Right there. Just like that. Well, this part of the shaft is done. So what we're going to do from here, this is just a little line because we're going to cut it off. It'll be a little over an inch long. We'll go to the bandsaw, cut this thing off, and then we're going to chuck this. We're going to go to our six jaw chuck and rechuck it, and we're going to finish this end right here. That's going to get pressed into our flange. I want to get a new accurate measurement on our bore here in the flange plate now that it's nice and cold. I'm just going to use a telescoping gauge and a 3-4 mic for this. So this is kind of borderline on whether you should use an inside mic for something like this, but I'm comfortable using telescope gauge. You get the right feel for it right there. Should be around 437. 435 and a half for that one. Go ahead and do it. We're going to do it a couple more times just to make sure that we get an accurate reading that repeats. There we go. 436, 436 and a half. So getting a thousandths difference there. That's why you check it multiple times and make sure that you have the telescope gauge in the center and pivot it properly. .436. Do it one more time and see what we get here. .436. Getting about a half a thousandths variation in that. So we will just end up making our shaft that's going to fit in this 437. Just give it 1/1000. That'll be good enough there to hold it on there and keep it nice and centered once we install it. We are going to finish our machining on our stub shaft here for our hitch crane. So we've got to finish out that side. We're going to use the good old TMX six jaw chuck here on the Victor lathe to finish out this this last lathe op here. I reinstalled the six jaw and then trued it up. This is the set true style, so you have the four set screws so that you can center it up and it should repeat well. I'm gonna go ahead and put an indicator on this and just see how close it's doing. Now I'm using a 1/1000th resolution indicator right here just for this little check, but I do use a tenths indicator to get it indicated right where we want. So looking at that indicator, I can see a half a thousandth run out, which is perfectly normal for this setup right here and perfectly suited for what we're doing. So Chuck always does a nice job. I got my dimensions written down. This isn't super critical right here. I wanted to have plenty of metal on this side of the flange here for a nice weld bead right there. As I said, we're going to be sitting down on this this face, so I don't want the weld bead coming down over onto the shoulder. So we'll just go ahead and clean that up. So it won't take much to turn this OD down because we're only taking a 16th off of it. Just start with half. Careful on that chrome plating like that. Just touch it and come off very quickly. doesn't like that depth of cut there. All right, so 50, 65, 67. So 467, we got 3, 4, 5, 6. So 30 thousandths to come off that. So what we will do is I'm gonna take half that, slow the feed rate down. Let's take 15. You wanna split your difference there, even out the tool pressure. And the chips are not cooperating with me today. You know, they're always gonna get in there at the last second and ruin your finish there. I'm gonna go ahead and kick it up to 600 RPM. Make sure I'm not measuring any of that dust that gets on there from the chip rubbing the surface there. All right, 51 is where we're at right there, so. Normally I split it in half and then that's it, but I'm going to go ahead and take another cut here because I'm changing the speed at the 5,000th cut. I think the tip of that insert tool, I can tell that it's worn. It needs to be replaced. It's still cutting fine, but it's not finishing fine. Yep, so that'll give us 3,000ths. I'm not gonna retract the tool. I'm just gonna back off there in case I need to take another cut there. See if I got us where we want. I was shooting for around 437 and a half, and we've got it at 438. That should be just fine. We should be able to get that press in there nice and easy. So we still need to cut our weld prep on there, and then this part will be done. Almost. Of course, it's going to... You got to get on and off quick with these wide cuts like this. You hear that chatter? What I want to get is about 3/8, so we're right there. All right, that'll be our weld prep. So once we get that everything welded together, we're going to chuck this back in the six jaw here, and we're going to face that side off so that all you'll be left with is you know, the weld bead inside of the V, but it'll be nicely and cleaned up machined surface there. Just do a quick verification of the fit, make sure I'm not reading the wrong numbers, and I can tell that's an interference fit right there. I'm thinking maybe we'll lay this guy on some fire brick and warm it up with the torch and see if we can just drop it on there, just let it heat shrink on there. We may do that.